Hello, ladies and gentlemen, this is Ivan Sokolov, and this is first in the set of four videos on material imbalances. I have divided this material into first video will be material imbalances connected to a queen. The second one would be a combination of material imbalances, which will start with a piece and then be a queen. And third and a fourth one are going to be related to an exchange, material imbalances related with an exchange. So now let's start with material imbalances related to a queen. I have picked up one quite topical variation of a Gruenfeld, where we reach such a kind of position by force. Let me just give you the first moves, so you would kind of know what I'm talking about. Queen b3, so this is a Russian variation of Gruenfeld. a6, which is called a Hungarian variation in many books. And here in this position, we actually have quite a theoretical move, which leads to a queen sacrifice. Move bishop e6, hitting a queen. Queen does not move, white takes on f6, bishop e3, white takes on g7. Black can now decide whether to move the bishop or the rook or to take a pawn. So he has to do something because he would lose some more material. King takes g7, ab3. Black now needs to take a pawn, which is logical. Knight d4, queen d4. So this is our starting position. This starting position also has occurred in many top games and is actually also important for a chess theory. But this is not a video on a chess theory. We are predominantly interested in these videos in middle games. But however, I did choose this position because I think this is an excellent learning example. I have enclosed a number of games in a PGN for those people who are interested in also getting, let's say, the theoretical grip of the position. I will go in this video only through our main games and through a couple of games which I gave in a PGN form, not all of them. So I advise a viewer who is more interested in a theoretical part of this position, who wants to play it either with white or black, to study my PGN. But now, okay, let's get to this middle game position. So what have you got here? Black is having a queen and the two pawns, and white is having three pieces, two bishops and a knight. So according to some sort of rules, let's say queen is normally evaluated by 9, pawns are evaluated by 1, so let's say black is having 11. Pieces are normally evaluated by 3, so white is having only 9. So you may argue that black is having material advantage in this position. However, in the positions with the queen sacrifices, especially queen versus 3 pieces, these material definitions are actually not really easy to stipulate or clever to blindly follow in the practical game. Why? Because actually pieces coordination is very important. What we are going to learn into this video, what I will try to explain, because it is not easy to give a set of rules. How do you play with a queen versus, let's say, 3 pieces, or how do you play with the 3 pieces versus queen? Why? Because positions are often tactical, they differ very much from each other, and it is not easy to give a set of rules. What I am trying to explain here with the games also included in a PGN, and why did I pick up this variation, is because I think in such a kind of position, it is extremely important for both sides to watch over material transformation. So a position, let's say, of a queen versus 3 pieces, how does it transform, let's say, in a position queen versus 2 pieces and rook? And who is to be favored in such a kind of position? We are going to see here from a number of games that actually very often 3 pieces versus this queen are going to function better, let's say, than knight, bishop and the rook. So let's see. Our main game is van der Stellen Timan. Timan has also played the same position later on, some years later, like almost 10 years later, with the white pieces. So castles, and here queen b4. Queen b4 is probably by far the best move, because what does black want with his queen? He wants to eat an extra pawn on b3. And now we will come to our first critical situation. Bishop f3. So rook on a8 is attacked. And right now, actually, by definition, in all the best games played, actually, best move here for black is to play queen takes b3 to allow white to take this exchange. Why does black want to do this? Well, black would like to do this because actually those three pieces combined with this rook, who can also get very active, you're going to see this shortly, actually are going to win a lot of tempis fighting against this queen. This is more or less what is happening. Now, how to get this situation done? In our main game, Van der Steren decided to play bishop a8, going for the material. We cannot really blame him because this was one of the first times that such a position came in a grandmaster practice. Later on, people tried either not to take exchange or to take it in a bit more sophisticated manner, like, for example, game between Bologan versus Swidler. Let's see first game between Bologan and Swidler, because Bologan tried to take the same exchange in a little bit more sophisticated manner, and we would also figure out in that position that actually taking an exchange was not so great, because actually then queen was fighting very well. So Bologan played bishop d5, queen b4, and now he took, with a basic idea compared to our main game, to win a tempo. Queen c5, what do we have here? We have here rook and two pieces versus queen and three pawns. So, more or less material balance. Black is maybe, let's say, having some small advantage of an extra pawn, if we are going to use the regular material tables. But however, what white wants to do, white is trying to coordinate his pieces and take tempos on a black queen, so that black is either going to lose more time or to lose material. So rook d1, rook d8, bishop e3 hitting a queen, queen c6. But we are going to see in this game that it's actually is going to be very difficult for white to coordinate. King f8, knight e3. Already, what black wants to do, if black can coordinate a bit his position, at some moment, his pawns, those extra pawns, are going to have its effect. Because maybe, let's say, one rule which makes sense here to give is that black should push those pawns, because white is trying to coordinate his rook and two pieces in order to gain initiative and a tempis of a black queen. However, if black manages to push his pawns, white is going to have less space. If he is having less space, he is going to find it harder to fight against black queen. So maybe, let's say, if you have similar kind of position, queen and the number of pawns versus light pieces or rook and two pieces, if you can push those pawns to gain space, it is normally a clever idea. Swidler played here a move queen e4. F6 was also a very reasonable move in order to start taking control of the squares and also to start pushing those pawns to gain space. So queen e4, bishop c5. What Swidler here wants to do, actually, move queen e4 was aimed as trading a pair of rooks. Whether it is more clever to play with a, let's say, queen versus two light pieces, let's say bishop, knight and the rook, or is it smarter to play queen and the rook versus bishop, knight and two rooks, it is difficult to say. It strictly depends actually on the position involved. In this particular case, it is probably intelligent to trade a pair of rooks what Swidler is doing. Why? Because he has many pawns which he would like to push. And the less pieces are on the board, well, the more difficult would be for white to coordinate his pieces. So now let's see. Swidler moves his king. Bologan plays move b4, trying to stop the pawns. Because if now black gets a time, because black moved his king because he wanted to eliminate a different kind of checks. So king e8. Now what black wants to do, black wants to start pushing his pawn. So Bologan plays move b4, hoping to stop it. But now actually comes a good move a5. Now the problem is if you take on a5, which he should have done, queen a4 comes and collects this pawn, but now white gets a kind of initiative. And this position is very messy. White is having rook and two pieces. Black is having those two pawns. Due to weakness of black king, it is difficult to advance those pawns. Computer is evaluating this position as an equal, giving like zeros. In a practical game, this position is very sharp because it is extremely easy to lose it with white, because simply black is having those two pawns that are simply going to run, actually, both of them. However, it is also not very difficult to lose this position with the black pieces. Why? Because you are having quite a weak squares around the king. So this is simply a very sharp position. Bologan played move knight d5. And now actually Svidler is going to get an upper hand. For example, here move f5 was probably a good move, just making extra space for a king. So that, let's say in the case of knight c7, you cannot take on a5 because queen c2 is hitting a rook and a bishop and will win material. So b5 is a terrible blunder. After knight c7, let's say king f7, knight d5, ab4, we are starting to actually see that I have included this in a PGN, that actually it is quite difficult for white now to coordinate his pieces. His pieces are starting to become loose. So this is, let's say, losing a piece. If you take bishop takes b4, then e6 is winning another piece. So white is having a problem because he cannot coordinate his pieces now very well. All his pieces are loose. Svidler in the game played move a takes b4. Bologan probably should have played knight c7, trying to coordinate his pieces better, because white here has to look for the tactics. If white runs of tactics, black pawns are going to be very dangerous. He took bishop b4, queen c2, and actually Bologan should have been in a terrible trouble in this game. He managed to save it, because Svidler missed some opportunities. Maybe you can see this in a PGN, due to time space on this video, I am only going to show critical moment, which was here. Here Svidler pushed immediately his pawn b3, and white managed to save the game. White probably would not have saved the game if black followed the principle which I mentioned, to take space, to push first e5. Because then the pieces would start to get very poorly coordinated, and white should be in a trouble in this position. He should basically lose the game, because now all the pieces of white are wrong, and black should actually now try to take some more space. On the long run, black should win this position. I will now get back to our main position. Probably best play actually for white is not to be in a hurry to take any kind of material. Timan playing this position with white pieces against Katarina Lachno, he played move rook a3, queen c4, knight d5. As we now see Timan playing it with white, he is not interested at all in taking exchange and taking any material. What he wants to do, he wants to coordinate his pieces to create an attack. And this is what he will manage to do. I think that he's playing this position in quite exemplary fashion. b4. Eliminating rook c3 threat. Rook e3, e6, now comes another tempo, b3. Idea is to place bishop on b2 with a check, so queen d4 needs to be played. Now rook e2. Now threat is bishop b2 in order to win a queen. Actually, black is here in a serious trouble. I mean, Timan played this position very nicely. Let's see it once more. Look, he's not in a hurry to take a material back. What he wants to do, he simply wants to coordinate his pieces, and he does it very well. He starts with a rook lift, queen c4, jumps with a knight, having a tactical threat of rook c3, b4, improves the rook, again with a threat, and now coordinates his bishop. And here actually black is in problems. Black here offers white to actually have another trade, to change material balance, playing move c6. Now it is not easy decision. Definitely Timan understood that after bishop b2, queen b2, rook b2, c takes d5, material balance situation transforms, and now we are having ending where white is having a bishop, black is having three pawns. How is this ending, this bishop versus those three pawns? I think, not easy to evaluate. I think it is probably easy to evaluate that white should be better. If somebody can win this position, it should be white. But can he win this? I don't know. Maybe draw is, let's say, the most objective outcome. That's why Timan decided to go for an attack, playing move knight e7, still following the same principle to keep the pieces and to keep his attack. And probably he played well. Rook c8. Here again, there is a decision. If white plays move rook d2, we are going to have again what I was talking about, situation of queen fighting, let's say, three pieces, transforming after rook d2 into something very different. Because here, since queen does not have a clever squares, let's say in the case of move like queen c5, there is a check. And then if a king moves, there is going to be move rook c1. And actually quite a big problems, because queen is running out of squares. There keeps on being this mating motive with 97. Queen g5 is now probably only move. So most likely, the best decision will be on rook d2 to play a move like rook takes c6. And after rook d6, rook d6, we again have a different material imbalance position. Rook and the two pawns fighting a bishop pair. How is the position? White looks a bit better. Can white, however, win this position? I don't know. Because what white will need to do, white will need to keep his b3 pawn alive. Because here, if queenside pawns disappear, then a rook and the four pawns fighting two bishops and three pawns is going to be a total draw. Timan decides to keep the material. Again, he declines to transpose into something different. Rook d8. Tactical shot, bishop h6. And here, white is having very serious attack. And black Lachno, actually, she does something very smart. She decides to actually give an exchange. She wants to give an exchange. We again have the situation that white, by taking exchange, wins material, but runs out of attack. White attacks, attack runs out of steam. And here, after rook d2, queen g5, rook d7, rook b3 taking a pawn was interesting. I gave some comment in a PGN on this. It is hard to say what is going on in this position. White is having some attack. So rook d7, rook f3 leads to a forced draw. h4, tactical motive, because winning a rook, I mean, move like, let's say, queen g4 is not going to help. I mean, it would be basically quite a serious blunder here because of move knight e5. So queen h4 needs to be done, and after taking a rook, there is a draw. So this was, I think, quite a nice game, showing white getting a pressure, and black actually, at some moment, offering an exchange in order for white initiative to run out of steam. Now let's get back to our main game. Van der Steren decides to take this exchange immediately. And we are now going to see that black is actually going to have quite easy play. And Timan plays in exemplary fashion. He is going to push his pawns as far as he can in order to gain space. The more space he is gaining, the more actually connectivity of white pieces is going to become a problem for white. a4, h3, and now Timan does according to book. e5. He's taking space. The more space he's taking, the more difficult will be for white to create some kind of play versus a queen. Knight e4, queen b2, bravely takes pawn, and correctly so, because there is actually nothing special here for white. White is here playing move bishop g5, trying to create some mating threat, which black eliminates very easily. Rook a6, rook d6, Timan wants, of course, to exchange rooks, but not at this particular moment, because now if he exchanges rooks, there is going to remain this bishop f6 check. So he keeps rook for a while. And here, white makes a mistake. Let's say white position is very difficult, and probably he will lose it anyway. But was better idea to play move rook a b1, let's say queen c2, hitting a knight f3. Creating a threat of rook c1. Like, for example, here move a3 is a terrible blunder because of move rook c1. and basically hitting a rook. This would actually lead to some sort of unclear situation. But okay, white is suffering in this position. This was a better way to fight. White decides to change rooks, and now we have the situation that actually rook exchange is going to be a problem for white, because with less pieces on a board, he's going to find it difficult to coordinate his pieces. Tiemann plays it very well here, plays h6, check. Pawn on c7 cannot be taken because of queen b1 check, taking a knight on e4. And after rook d1, g5, liberating king. Now there is no way that there is ever going to be any mating threat. f3, a3, and actually white resigned because pawn is going to queen. So in this advice, viewers to study the BGM, because there are a number of games here, but the basic, if I would need to give some kind of basic rules in this kind of position, I will repeat it once more. If you are playing with, let's say, three pieces versus queen and a number of pawns, coordination of pieces is crucial. Do not be in a hurry to grab your material back. Be more focused on coordinating pieces. And this game between Tiemann playing this position with white versus Lachno, which you can find in the PGN, and I did just show to you, is actually a very good example of how games should be played. If you are playing this from a black side, for the side, let's say, of queen playing versus three pieces, consider very often that giving an exchange back in order to remove, let's say, one of the bishops can be very beneficial, because it may become more difficult for your opponent to coordinate the remains of his pieces. If you are playing with a queen and a number of pawns, try to push those pawns as far as you can in order to take space. The more space you take, the more difficult will be for a side playing with the minor pieces or playing with a rook and two minor pieces to coordinate power of those pieces versus queen. So positions are mostly complex, but I hope that this particular game and a PGN enclosed and a number of advices will actually help you handle such a kind of difficult positions. Thank you.